candidates who say they've got what it takes to help run the city. They're all people campaigning to be councillors in this fall's municipal election. They range in age from 25 to 65. Many are first-time politicians. Some of them immigrated here from other countries. What they share is a passion and a desire to set things right. I'm also joined by a panel of reporters ready to inject a dose of reality to examine whether what could or should be done has any real chance of surviving at City Hall. We'll also be taking questions from people seated in our audience here at Glen Gould Studio and from you listeners who might want to email us from home. So sit up, listen carefully, and stay tuned for New Visions for Toronto, the Candidates Debate. Alejandro Bravo in Davenport, running against incumbent Cesar Palacio. Krach Anijan, who is in Scarborough, Rouge River. Debbie Lecter, running in Jane Pitfield's former ward of Don Valley West. And John Sewell, no stranger to Toronto political, the political scene, a former mayor, in fact. He's now running in the ward of St. Paul's against incumbent Joe Mahevic. You can now welcome them all. I'd like to begin this evening by asking you all to respond briefly to the same question in just a few seconds, if you might, for the question, and we'll start with you, John Sewell. Why you? Why now? Why again? I guess I could add.
I decided to run because I came to the conclusion that people at City Hall had fallen asleep, and they needed a wake-up call. They needed some new energy, and new direction, new ideas, in fact, new vision. As to why I'm running in Ward 21, well, that's where I live. And I believe we need a better balance between the big city and neighborhoods. Neighborhoods are losing out. And in order to make neighborhoods strong, you have to have candidates who actually live there. And I live in Ward 21.
Thank you. Debbie Lecter, you're a partner in a successful software company running for the first time against 14 other candidates in Ward 26. Jane Pitfield's the mayoral candidate's former ward. Why you? Why now?
I've decided to do this because, like many of you, I'm a concerned citizen who feels that the quality of life in Toronto is actually declining. We're now in a cycle where we see everything going up and our services going down. I believe that it doesn't always take a lot of money to solve a problem. As a business person, I've learned that often it's not about a lack of funds, but a lack of leadership and imagination. Like John said, the time is now greater than ever for new vision, new energy, and new people at City Hall, people with the skills and determination to make a difference.
Krachanita Jin, you worked as an assistant to three other counselors, but now you're taking a crack at the job yourself. So why you, why now?
Well, Andy, I've been for 16 years at City Hall backstage puppeteer. It's time for me to be a puppet.
I think you want to turn that around. I think you want to be a puppeteer instead of a... You want to be a puppet?
Well, no, I think I want to be a puppet now.
Okay.
It's time for me to shine.
Okay. Alejandro Bravo, a native of Chile, you're now active in Toronto's Latino community. You ran for council last election and come fairly close, came in fairly close second. Why you, why now again?
Well, Ward 17 needs more, Andy, and because of weak leadership, we haven't been getting it. I am raising my family in the community, and I expect more from my family. I think as residents, we should all expect more. In this city, we have a fundamental choice to make over the next 10 to 30 years about how we're going to grow. Right now, a growing majority of us are born outside of Canada, but our communities face poverty and are left out. I think that we need to change that, and what we need is to deliver on the services and build the infrastructure that breaks down barriers so that everyone can participate fully, and that means in the economic and political life of the city. I know that as a new generation of progressive leaders, I can deliver.
And finally, Donald Blair, age 25, you're a successful IT consultant. You started your own business out of high school. You now work for BMO Financial Group. You ran 3 years ago. You came in last then. Why you? Why now?
Well, coming in last gave me an experience that I could use to build to come in first this time. The city lacks a clear vision and direction. It lacks innovative ideas, thinking outside of the box, and it's lost its sense of fiscal responsibility, and it completely alienates taxpayers. And I feel that the city needs new, fresh, young blood with new ideas and new thoughts bold and accountable decision makers, leaders who actually listen to their community, and people who will actually look at the area that I come from, Scarborough, and consider it a part of Toronto, which it is.
Thank you. You're listening to New Visions for Toronto, the candidates' debate on CBC 99.1. I'm Andy Berry. We're live in Glengold Studio at the CBC Broadcasting Centre. I'm joined on stage by a handful of hopeful candidates who just heard from the would-be councillors come election day on the 13th of November. And with me as well, a quartet of city
building an incinerator in your ward as a long-term, made-in-Toronto solution to deal with our trash. John Sewell?
Well, I'm delighted that the city has purchased a landfill site. I wish I knew the details of its cost to see whether it's a wise thing. There's no question in my mind the very first thing we have to do about solid waste is actually have a place to put it in the ground. So that's a start. In terms of building an incinerator, the cost of running an incinerator, even with the revenue that's flowing in from electricity that might be produced, is in the order of twice the cost of landfill. And I think what one has to deal with is whether or not that's where people think it's really important to put money. And I'm quite willing to have a big debate about that, but to actually come and say, oh yeah, I want to spend all my money on that, rather than, as an example, kids and recreation programs and shared use programs in schools, I wouldn't be willing to jump at that right away.
Incinerator in their backyard. If not there, then where? The likelihood of the residents of Leaside to accept an incinerator is quite low. However, I'm glad you asked me the question about trash, because I have to make this point. I think that the decision to actually purchase the landfill put politics first and people second. Let's not have any mistakes here. That landfill comes with an expiry date, the year 2018. It's a short-term solution. I don't understand why the people at City Council, or certain members of the City Council, didn't even want to consider looking at other technologies, safe, clean alternatives to landfills such as incineration. And I would be very comfortable considering building an incinerator and putting it somewhere in Ward 26. In fact, there's some absolutely great locations for it. There's brownfield type of development, and we already have a lot of contaminated land there, so I think it makes perfect sense to consider at least some other form of technology like an incinerator, a sorting facility, which would actually be excellent for managing waste in high-rise apartments and recycling, or some other type of technology which actually harnesses waste and turns it into energy. I would rather consider these technologies than sit around and watch garbage pile up in a pit for the next 10 years.
We had a report on the Gardner Expressway. That report recommended taking much of it down from Spadina east out to the Don Valley Parkway. The cost is expensive, up to $1 billion, maybe even more. But it also says leaving it the way it is and maintaining it really wouldn't save any money in the long run. So I'd be interested to know from some of you, what would you do with the Gardner if it was your decision? And I'm go to the suburbs first and ask Donald Blair from Scarborough. What do you want to see happen to the Gardner?
I'll occasionally commute on the Gardner, and when I work downtown for a period of time, I commuted on the Gardner. It's not a priority in council's next term. Just simply put, we've got a lot of issues that we have to resolve first, and after 4 years, I would support looking at ways to bury it. I think that it's a major artery. To completely tear it down and replace it with a 10-lane boulevard, I'm sure that there are people who are concerned about access to the waterfront with an elevated structure, but I would also be just as concerned about access to the waterfront crossing 10 lanes of traffic. And I think that that's something that that does need to be addressed, but not in the next 4 years. It's not a priority.
What would you do with the garden?
Well, I don't think it's a huge priority for people in my community. I've been knocking on doors since the report came out and asked people what they thought. Personally, I think that it would be important to take it down for revitalization, but I have to agree that in the next term of council, I don't think we're there yet. We haven't done enough to build the public transit infrastructure to deal with the pressure that it would mean to remove the Gardner. And, you know, we're not even, the ridership growth strategy is great, but we haven't even gotten to the point where we're providing adequate all-day public transit service every 20 minutes. to huge parts of the city. So I think, to me, bringing in to the public transit network, people, whether you live at Caledonia and Edmonton in my ward, or somewhere in Scarborough, has to be a far higher priority. Because if you don't have access to good public transit, you can't get to work on time, you can't get your kids to school, then you don't have an essential tool for living and working in this city, and that means that you're less than
your priority list.
Well, I mean, if the question is, do you tear it down? The answer is, of course you tear it down, but then the question is, what do you do then? And you have to sort that out before you tear it down. It's very clear that what we should be doing is replacing that road capacity with transit capacity. In a really serious way, so we have to. That gets us into the whole question: what do you do when you've got a bankrupt city, which is what we've got now?
Where
is
the room on the capital side? Since you have less revenue sources than any city over 500,000 North America, and lower property tax, and you're not prepared to consider things like user pay garbage, which half the cities in Canada have. And why should I pay for my garbage on my property tax bill? Quite frankly, and why shouldn't, because I recycle, why don't
so paying for garbage on your property tax bill, will you generate more money by putting tags, creating an entire
you save a lot because people think twice before they throw stuff out. Like, look at this, Calgary.
Oh, thank you very much.
Vancouver, Edmonton have user pay. I mean, all kinds of anyway, have a look at that.
It's certainly food for thought.
Don't paint yourself in the corner before you get elected because you've taken all the options off the table.
Well,
at least say, I'm not sure about that, but I certainly look at it.
Well,